strategic in value. Why were both presidents, the president of the Confederate States and the president of the United States, focused on this particular city? Starting now, Jake's going to start getting you into not only the actions that took place in 1862 and 1863, but now we're going to start introducing more and more of the personalities, so that you can kind of put the leader, the action stuff all put together, because that's really, though, we've set the stage. Now it's time to start the story. So I'll go ahead and get out of Jake's way.
How is everybody still awake? Still excited?
Yep.
Well, I'm going to do all of 1862 Vicksburg in about an hour, give or less. So like Tim said, I'm going to focus a lot on the personalities. So I'm the first one really in this series to talk about many of the key players. We'll talk about in the coming weeks. So I'll give an overview of the actions, but especially for what you guys are doing, guys and ladies, going through the park, taking groups around, you're going to be focusing a lot on the siege and not so much on some of the naval actions. So I'm going to focus a lot on the players. Now, of course, what brings the Navy to Vicksburg, and it's this famous Anaconda Plan. Did David mention this last week? Mm-hmm. Okay, I was in Washington, D.C. last week playing in the snow, so I wasn't able to be here. This is a political cartoon of the Anaconda Plan, the much-derided Anaconda Plan. It's devised by Winfield Scott. He's a hero of the War of 1812 and the Mexican-American War, so he's been around quite a while. He's the commanding general of all armies at the start of the war. The basic idea of the plan was to choke the Confederacy to death slowly by blockading the waterways and ports so they couldn't get supplies in, get anything out. That's the general idea. It's not liked by a lot of those in the North who want the war to be over in a month. As we learned in the summer of 1861, that's not going to be the case either. So for more or less, the North does adopt this plan. However, Lincoln's a lot more offensive-minded. He wants to get the war over with, which of course is going to match well with Grant and Sherman later on. But with that mindset, it's essentially going to be the Anaconda Plan, which brings the Union Navy and later the Army to Vicksburg. Now the West Gulf Blockading Squadron, they're going to be the first ones to reach Vicksburg. This is a photograph of the USS Hartford, which was Admiral Farragut's flagship. The West Gulf Blockading Squadron fulfilled a lot of the blockading duties of the Anaconda Plan. They're primarily tasked with preventing Confederate ships from supplying troops and supplies, and they're also supporting the Union troops along the coast. Actually, the western half of the Gulf Coast, from the mouth of the Mississippi River to the Rio Grande, and south of the mouth of the Rio Grande, beyond the border with Mexico. This squadron's created in 1862 when the Gulf Blockading Squadron, one big squadron, is cut in half between east and west. And from January of 1862 to November of 1864, it's commanded by David Glasgow Farragut. And this is later Admiral Farragut. He's actually the first admiral in the United States Navy. He was born in 1801. His father was actually a Spanish merchant from Minorca who moved to the colony of South Carolina. He served as a naval officer for the colony's navy during the Revolution, then later the United States Navy during the Revolution, colonial navy. And then later he was a cavalry officer in the Tennessee militia, so post-war. Farragut's actually born outside of Knoxville. There is the town of Farragut outside of Knoxville today. He's born as James Farragut. He picks up David later. We'll get that in a minute. His father moves down to New Orleans. He takes a job there, I believe, as some type of a customs official with the docks. And down there, like so many others, his mother dies of yellow fever. So his father's forced to place some of his children with other homes where they'll be cared for better. He's not able to do that with his job. So James, remember, not yet David, agrees to go with David Porter, who's a friend of his father's from the Navy days during the Revolution. And he's formally adopted by David Porter in 1808. That's where he picks up David. He's going to change his first name to David in 1812 in honor of his stepfather. And he grows up with Porter's sons, David Dixon Porter, who we'll hear about a little bit later, and William Porter, who's also mentioned later. He began his naval career as a young midshipman at the age of 9, something we can't quite imagine in this day and age. But prior to the founding of the Naval Academy at Annapolis, the way that they did it was almost like an apprenticeship program where you serve as a midshipman, you're kind of like a mini officer, you're definitely not enlisted. There's a strong caste system in the Navy, but you learn the tools of the trade until you pass examinations to become a lieutenant. I really recommend you see the movie Master and Commander. It shows the British Navy during the War of 1812 era, but that's the same mindset that Farragut, Porter, and the others would have learned under. We mentioned a lot with the Army following what the French do, the Navy, they follow what the British do. Farragut's going to be wounded fighting the British in the War of 1812, and you could really make a movie on his life. So he goes from a young midshipman in the War of 1812, he gets to chase pirates around the Caribbean in the 1820s. In the 1850s, jumping ahead, he commissions the Mare Island Navy Yard in Vallejo, California. Once the Civil War breaks out, the Navy at first doubts his loyalty due to he being born in Tennessee and his wife's born in Virginia. So somebody we'll get to in the coming weeks, John Pemberton, a Pennsylvanian's wife from Virginia, he decides to go to the South. Farragut, however, stays loyal to the North. His stepbrother, David Dixon Porter, is actually going to speak to his defense, and so he's trusted and he's given command of the West Gulf Blockading Squadron. Now, inching closer and closer to Vicksburg, they decide to start moving up the river. So on April 25th, Farragut's fleet is going to capture New Orleans. They're going to bombard the fortifications for a few days. That's actually going to be Porter's job with the mortar boats. And Farragut's going to end up just running right up the river, sick of waiting for the forts to surrender, and he's going to move right up and capture New Orleans. When they come past Baton Rouge has no garrison, and so just peacefully surrender, hand over the keys to the city, in essence. And then we get to Natchez. And moving here about 5 years ago, I heard a lot of Vicksburg natives talk very derisively about Natchez. Because they surrender without a fight, Vicksburg, of course, goes through this nasty siege. And the one thing that people won't tell you a lot of times is that Natchez had a garrison of a total of 14 men against the whole Union Navy, so they really didn't have a chance. But Natchez surrenders, and the Navy's really excited because they think this is just going to continue on when they get to Vicksburg. That, of course, is not the case. Now, the first contact at Vicksburg is going to take place on May 18th. Captain Lee, of course, no relation whatsoever to Robert E. Lee or even Stephen D. Lee, who we'll talk about, he's commander of the Oneida, one of Farragut's ships, and it reaches the city on the May 18th, and he demands the surrender of the city. He gets some very interesting replies from Lieutenant Colonel James Autry, who's for the state of Mississippi forces. It's with the Confederate Army, you have state forces, kind of like home guard troops, and then you have the regular Confederate Army. Autry's with the Mississippi forces, and he pokes some sticks at the Union Navy and Army. I have to state that Mississippians don't know and refuse to learn how to surrender to an enemy. If Commodore Farragut or Brigadier General Butler can teach them, then let him try. He purposely demotes both Farragut and Butler in his reply, so a little bit of an attitude there. General Martin L. Smith, who's in command of the Confederate defenses in Vicksburg at that time, states, having been ordered to hold these defenses, it is my intention to do so as long as in my power. And the mayor of the city, Lazarus Lindsay, says neither the municipal authorities nor the citizens will ever consent to a surrender of the city. I find this interesting because it's May 18th. Think about May 18th the next year when Grant Army arrives outside the city. So very interesting with that date. Now the first bombardment's gonna be on May
26th.
62. Yes, correct. And a Confederate soldier's gonna state that the shells caused such a miserable squawking and scratching and getting along through the wind I never did hear, which, if you're under bombardment like that, that's about the best description I could think of. And also, I had the benefit of listening to some of the questions that you all asked Will. And this is from Martin Luther Smith, This is one of the books on your bibliography, Mike Ballard's book on the Vicksburg campaign. I highly recommend it. But this is right out of there. Mark Luther Smith says that from May 26th, the ensuing 10 days I consider the most critical period of the defenses of Vicksburg. Batteries incomplete, guns not mounted, troops few, and both officers and men entirely new to service, and not a single regular officer to assist in organizing and commanding. Had a prompt and vigorous attack been made by the enemy, while I think the dispositions made would have ensured the repulse, still the issue would not have been less certain than at any time afterwards. And a few of you asked about the defenses the Confederates had at that time. Like I said, I had the fortune of sitting in the back and listening, so I looked up in the book here. And he mentions that the defensive line on May 20th included 7 batteries, 2 above the town to protect upriver approaches, and 5 below to meet the more immediate threat posed by the Union boats. The 5 batteries included 18 guns, a combination of smoothbores, which had limited range and power, and more effective rifled pieces. A rifled 18-pounder would become known in Vicksburg lore as Whistling Dick because of the whistling noise shells made after being fired. These weapons were the sum total of all Smith's heavy guns, except for 2 42-pounder smoothbores sent up the Yazoo to protect construction of the Arkansas. So that answers the question you had earlier there. Now we have the other Union Navy force. I may mention, going back and forth, if you're not familiar with the terms, I may mention Blue Water Navy and Brown Water Navy. Blue Water Navy's Farragut's fleet, the West Gulf Blockading Squadron, they're the, you know, what you think of when you think of the Navy, the ships with the big sails, the much larger ships like the Hartford we showed earlier. The Brown Water Navy's the River Navy. It's built almost exclusively from scratch. You get that tour of the Cairo later on in the training, and Ray will definitely go into that more. But the Brown Water Navy are kind of the short little ugly boats, but they do a lot of work here on the rivers. The vessel seen here is the USS Conestoga, which is a timber-clad. There's a few different types of ships. We have ironclads like the Cairo, timber-clad like the Conestoga, and there's also tin-clads, which for some reason don't sound quite as safe as timber-clads or ironclads. But the signal's an example of those. Now, the Western Flotilla, it operates on the Western rivers. It's initially a part of the Army, and that's going to cause a lot of confusion. It's under the command of the Army, but there's Navy officers on board the boats. It will be transferred to the Navy in October of 1862, but not before a whole summer of confusion that we're getting into. It's renamed the Western Gunboat Squadron, and while under the Army, it had worked in conjunction with the Army at Fort Henry and Donelson. Actually, the ships are the ones that pound Fort Henry into surrendering on its own. Donelson, Island Number 10, and a few of the timberclads are going to be at Shiloh and really help out in that night between the 2 days battle, and keeping the Confederates at bay. The Western Gunboat Squadron, Flotilla, also fought exclusive naval actions at Fort Pillow, not the battle we always think of at Fort Pillow in 1864, but a naval battle in 1862 when the Union captures it. And then also the naval battle of Memphis. Andrew Foote's going to be the commander from August of 61 to May of 1862. Charles Davis commands from May 1862 to October of 1862. And David Dixon Porter, who we've mentioned briefly, we'll get into more detail on him. He commands from October 1862 to July of 1864. Now, we mentioned all the cities to the south that had fallen, and I just briefly mentioned the capture of Memphis. That's going to take place on June the 6th, on D-Day. The Union Navy is going to destroy the last Confederate naval presence on the Mississippi River other than the CSS Arkansas, which is still being worked on. So that's a very forgotten about battle, but it's very crucial. The second bombardment of Vicksburg is going to take place on June the 26th. This is mainly going to come from Porter's mortar boats. At 3:30 p.m., they're going to open fire. The Confederates are going to return fire, but they have very limited ammunition, so it's going to slowly slacken off and then stop firing altogether. The mortars are going to continue to fire periodically, but more just for the sake of doing it rather than really hoping to do damage. One thing I'll also mention, this is going to be talked about a little bit more on March 11th on that program. I believe Ray's doing that. But at this time, late June of 1862 is when the canal across the river we know as Grant's Canal is really started under General Williams, which is a brigade of infantry that's Farragut's infantry support when he moves up. So they do start digging the canal in late June of 1862. Now, we all know about the very famous running of the batteries that takes place when Grant moves across the river in April of 1863. Farragut's going to do the same thing in June, except going north with over 30 warships and mortar boats running from the south. The idea is at best to pound the Confederate defenses into submission, which is very wishful thinking from what we've heard about the gunfire back and forth from the ships. And at worst, leave part of their force north of Vicksburg so that they can link up with the Brownwater Navy when they arrive. There weren't really many casualties on either side, and the fleet didn't lose a ship as it got north, but essentially they move here and nothing else happens. But it will. We mentioned the Arkansas earlier, and the Arkansas is going to come into play in a big way. On the left, you see the action that occurs first on the Yazoo River. On the right's a painting of the action that occurs right below Vicksburg. Now, the Carondelet, one of the sister ships of the Cairo, the city-class gunboats, it moves up the Yazoo in search of the Arkansas with a few other ships, some tinclads, and it finds the Arkansas, probably wishes it didn't. They'll actually slug it out for about an hour. The Arkansas is going to attempt to ram the Carondelet, and the steering mechanism of the Carondelet gets beat up a little bit so that it kind of lists into the bank, and it's immobile. It can't move. So the Arkansas goes after the tinclads that had run away as soon as the heavy gun support was out of the way. With the Carondelet drifting, the Arkansas followed the other Union ships into the Mississippi, and instead of running into one or two boats, it ran into 33 vessels. So it had to be a little bit of surprise on their face, but the commander of that boat, Isaac Brown, was a really bulldog of an officer. His boat was really starting to get beat up, and he just wanted to go after more and more and more there. The Arkansas did reach the cover of the Vicksburg batteries and pulls up to the dock, but it had taken a beating and lost close to 40 men. There's an account of the Vicksburg civilians rushing down to the docks to cheer on the Arkansas after having watched the battle, and they open up the gangplank and blood literally runs down the plank onto the dock, and people are kind of taken aback and see what really happens inside of one of these boats when cannons fire at it. Farragut's a little bit upset that this one boat had caused so much trouble. So that night, I remember taking his ships north. He takes some of them south again to kind of do a drive-by shooting against the Arkansas, for lack of a better term. They're going to exchange fire with the Arkansas, but that boat's going to return fire back. The Arkansas is going to lose 19 more men. Combined Union Navy casualties for the day were 78. So you have to give credit to the Arkansas and say it got the best of the situation. The Union Navy is still upset about this boat. So on the 22nd, actually they planned it a few days earlier, the 16th, but the orders didn't work out and they delayed it until the 22nd. They planned a joint attack between both the forces north of the city and those south of the city. But it doesn't go as planned and only two boats end up attacking. One of those is going to be the Essex here, commanded by David Porter's brother, William. So you've just got a whole family reunion with the Navy going on here. Although the fighting was at close range, point blank, few casualties are fired. The Essex at one point almost runs aground. But fortunately for them, they're able to pull away. But you just have this brutal firing back and forth of ironclad against ironclad. But with little damage, Porter calls off the attack when the other forces from the south under Farragut fail to show up, so the Arkansas survives again. Farragut is going to withdraw because he's sick of being here, honestly. He'd always been on the open water, and there's an account when he describes when he first gets into the river, and he just feels so claustrophobic with the banks on either side. So he's a definite blue water Navy man. And if you look at his career the rest of the war, the most enclosed position he seems to go into is a bay, Mobile Bay. But other than that, he's out on the open ocean a lot. And in his defense, there is falling water to contend with. The river's lowering, and that's not good for those deep water ships. Also, you have the overconfidence that had kicked in after the quick victories at New Orleans, Baton Rouge, Memphis, and Natchez. Excuse me. The naval officers also did not seem to work well together. And then you have that confusion between the blue water navy that's under command of the Navy and the brown water navy under command of the Army, who's really in command of the whole group. There's a lot of friction there. So that's essentially the issues with the Navy in the summer of 1862. We've done the Navy and we're going to move on to the Army, but we haven't finished up with the Arkansas yet. Now, I mentioned the trouble with the Union Army controlling the brown water navy. The Confederates had the same issue. The Arkansas is put under the command of Earl Van Dorn. And what he decides to do, he's had a really rough year, and he decides to try to resurrect that by recapturing Baton Rouge. So he'll send a force down to Baton Rouge to attack General Williams, who had started the canal. He's going to be killed in that attack. I believe Todd, I forget his first name, Mary Lincoln's brother, I believe he's killed in that battle as well.
David was here. Oh, that's right.
Okay, well, some relation is with that battle, cousin or something. I'm drawing a blank. The Arkansas gets sent down there. The commander, Isaac Brown, is not there at the time. Otherwise, likely he would not have let it go because it had a lot of mechanical issues they've been working on. He arrives to the bank about 4 hours after it set sail, so he likely can't even see it go. It doesn't even make it down to Baton Rouge, and there's Union warships in the area, so the Confederates actually scuttle it because it has issues. They don't want it to fall into Union hands because the Union doesn't need another boat. So it's scuttled and it's out of the picture. The Confederates run it down itself. Now, Earl Van Dorn here, he's going to play a big part coming up here in the fall of 1862 around Vicksburg. And he's actually a local. He's born at Port Gibson. He's considered impulsive and emotional. He'd like to paint and write poetry. And he's also known for his love of women. He's referred to by a reporter at the time as the terror of ugly husbands. This is going to lead to his demise in May of 1863 when he's actually shot and killed by a jealous husband. He'd been in the West Point class of 1842. Up until the time of the Mexican-American War, he'd been at different garrisons throughout the South. During the Mexican-American War, he fights very well. He seems to be in the thick of the action. He's wounded twice and bumped up with brevets in rank twice. So he has a very successful Mexican-American War. He returns after that war is over. He'll fight the Seminoles for a time in one of the many Seminole Wars. And then he'll get sent to the 2nd Cavalry, the very famous pre-war 2nd Cavalry, commanded by Robert E. Lee, with George H. Thomas as one of the officers. And he'll fight the Comanches there. He's wounded 4 times, and he's promoted to a major. He resigns his commission in 1861, and he's given the rank of Brigadier General in the state militia once Mississippi seceded. And after Jefferson Davis is appointed president, it's going to be Van Dorn that's going to take over as commander of all the Mississippi state troops before all the Army troops are combined. Once that happens, he's a colonel in the Confederate Army. He'll quickly raise up to major general. He's going to have a rough start, though. He's going to be defeated at the Battle of Pea Ridge in Arkansas. Then he's going to make an attack on Corinth after it's already been captured by the Union after Shiloh. And he's going to be beaten back there. So his star's kind of fading a little bit. He's returned to the cavalry where he seems to have done best, and it's going to work out really well. You have this issue in the Civil War with overpromotion. You have officers that seem like they do really good at a level, so naturally you want to bump them up a level. The best example of that for those that read a lot of Civil War is John Bell Hood. He was arguably the best division commander in the Army of Northern Virginia. Decent corps commander, but when he's put in command of an army, bad things happened, that he just was probably overpromoted. I think that's the case with Van Dorn, too. You probably couldn't find a better cavalry officer. It would have been really interesting to see what he could have done in 1863, 64, even into 65 if he wouldn't have been killed so early. He's actually, as a side note, buried in Port Pitt. He's actually buried in Port Gibson, and he'll give his best performance, perhaps, for the Confederacy coming up here. We mentioned David Dixon Porter. This is David Dixon Porter. He's born in 1813. He's going to begin his naval service as a midshipman at age 10, so 1 year up from Farragut. His father, it seems like the Porters, and I'll have a really good quote that mentions the Porters in a minute. The Porters always had a very thin skin. His father's reprimanded in 1824, and rather than facing the music, he kind of takes his ball and goes home. At that time, he's very fortunate. Mexico is rebelling against Spain. So he takes over command of the new Mexican Navy, and he takes two of his sons along, David, who's 12 years old, and Thomas, who's 10 years old. Unfortunately for Thomas, he's going to die of yellow fever shortly after their arrival. David, however, is going to see a lot of action fighting against Spain. He's wounded and captured, and after that, his father doesn't want to risk his life anymore, so he's sent to New Orleans. And he is reappointed into the United States Navy as a midshipman for the second time at age 16 in 1829. He'll rise to lieutenant finally in 1841. The Mexican-American War, most of that's infantry and land battles and very tiny naval segments, but he does perform well and gets his first ship command during that small portion. Another thing that we talk about a lot at Vicksburg is camels, with Douglas the camel. Porter actually brings two shiploads of camels over to the United States when Jefferson Davis is Secretary of War. That's one of the many reforms he tries to pass with the Army. So it's actually Porter that carries that out and brings two shiploads of camels over. I just thought that was interesting to add in. After the Civil War begins, he commands the fleet of mortar barges that we mentioned at New Orleans and Vicksburg. And when the Mississippi Squadron switched over to the Navy, he's put in command of that force. He's made an acting rear admiral. Upon promoting Porter, Secretary of the Navy Gideon Welles is going to write some interesting things in his diary. Relieved Davis, meaning Charles Davis, and appointed D.D. Porter to the Western Flotilla, which is hereafter to be recognized as a squadron. Porter is but a commander, meaning his rank. He has, however, stirring and positive qualities, is fertile in resources, has great energy, excessive and sometimes not over-scrupulous ambition, is impressed with and boastful of his own powers, given to exaggeration in relation to himself, a Porter infirmity. Is not generous to older superior living officers, whom he is ready to traduce, but is kind and patronizing to favorites who are juniors and generally to official inferiors. Is given to cliquism, but is brave and daring like all his family. It is a question, with his mixture of good and bad traits, how he will succeed. So there's a lot of good, but there's a lot which you could probably call bad that's mixed in there. The General Grant's going to enter the picture here, and his plan for November, December of 1862 is for him to lead this force down along the railroad, hoping to draw all the Confederates up away from Vicksburg so that Sherman can just come right down the river and essentially walk in the back door to Vicksburg. So we know this doesn't work out as planned. And General Grant, I'm going to mention a few things about him very quickly. Most people are probably very familiar with Grant. He does become president after all. The one thing I want to stress as a native Ohioan, that Grant is from the great state of Ohio. He is not from Illinois. They keep trying to steal him. Grant's very introverted, and they say that comes from his mother, who is very quiet. Yes?
Where did you go to school?
I actually went to a small school.
Oh, there's Ohio State.
I did not go to the Ohio State University. Okay. But a very small school near there. a little bit off track there. He's an expert horseman. When he was at West Point, he actually held an equestrian jumping record that lasted for 25 years. So you may almost say, especially when he's younger, he's more comfortable around horses than people. He graduated 21st out of 39 in the West Point class of 1843. When he gets into the Army, he gets sent into the infantry. I'm sure he would have loved to be in the cavalry with his love of horses, but where you got assigned, depending on your rating and class, those in the top went into engineers. Samuel Lockett that Will mentioned, he's, I believe, either first or second in his class when his state secedes. Second. The next ring would be artillery. That's where Sherman's going to get bumped into because he graduated sixth in his class. After that, you have cavalry, then you have artillery, or excuse me, then you have infantry. All the less bright students get thrown in the infantry. Fortunately for him, he's going to be put in the position of regimental quartermaster. That's going to pay great dividends once the Civil War starts. It's one of his great strengths. You can look at this campaign especially, that is logistics. And you can't stress the importance of logistics enough, and he's a master of that. A lot of that's due to his time early on in the Army on a smaller level. Despite having essentially a staff job in the Mexican-American War, he seemed to always find ways to get into the action. There's a very famous story of him carrying a dispatch, riding on a horse that had one stirrup shot off, hugging the side while being fired at, racing through a city, being fired at by snipers. Also, later in the war, he finds a way to get an artillery piece up into a church tower. So he does some very impressive things, the kind of stuff you can't make up. In his memoirs, he's going to state that he learns about military leadership by observing decisions and actions of his commanding officers in Mexico, particularly Zachary Taylor. And you could argue he modeled himself after Taylor to a certain extent. Taylor was not, he was the very exact opposite of Winfield Scott. Winfield Scott was very nice, flashy dress uniforms, a gorgeous stallion, probably a gilded sword on his shoulder, all the lace, brass, anything you could put on. Zachary Taylor a lot of times wore a white duster, a straw hat, and no mark of military rank. You see Grant during the Civil War, and it's very much the same thing. Sherman to a certain extent as well. He writes later on the Mexican War, it's very interesting to hear somebody who later becomes a very successful general stating things like this. But in his memoirs, he writes, "I was bitterly opposed to the measure, and to this day regard the war which resulted as one of the most unjust ever waged by a stronger nation against a weaker nation." He's also going to later say that the Civil War was inflicted on the nation as punishment for its aggression in Mexico. So he does not have good feelings about the Mexican-American War. He's going to be stationed out in California away from his family. And while there, he tries to augment his lieutenant's pay with running some different business ventures. He's going to be swindled a couple times. Every single one of them is going to fail. And this is going to lead to rumors of drinking. He's going to be promoted to captain in 1853. But in July of 1854, he's basically going to be given the choice of resigning and keeping face or being drummed out of the Army for drinking, going through a court-martial. So he resigns in 1854. The last part of the 1850s are just miserable for him. He gets to the low of having to sell wood in the streets of St. Louis, borrowing money from former West Point classmates. And then he gets a job as a clerk in his younger brother's store in Illinois. That's how he ends up in Illinois, and they try to steal him from Ohio. At the start of the war, I'm bitter about that if you can't tell. At the start of the war, he's given a position by Governor Yates of Illinois as both a recruiter and a trainer of infantry soldiers. It takes him a while to get a commission because he still has that reputation about him within Army circles. He actually writes to George McClellan a number of times. To try to get him into the Army, and McClellan's not even going to bother to return his letters. He's eventually given command of the 21st Illinois. They're a unit that has been on the verge of mutiny, very bad discipline. Very quickly, he turns them around like that and shows what he can do. So he's promoted to Brigadier General and really takes off. He has success at the battles of Belmont, Fort Donelson, where he gets the nickname Unconditional Surrender Grant. During the surrenders, soldiers who are now Confederates that had loaned him the money, he actually pays some of that back after the surrender takes place. I'm sure that had to be a very interesting conversation. The Battle of Shiloh occurs, and he's going to get a bad rap for being surprised at Shiloh. But he was so determined the second day, a lot of the credit goes to Buell's army for saving him there. But if you believe what Sherman says, Sherman wants to maybe break the idea of falling back, but he decides not to and makes a comment to the extent of it was a heck of a day today. And Grant doesn't miss a beat and just kind of nods with that grim determination, probably a cigar chomped in his mouth saying, yeah, but we'll whip them tomorrow. That's the type of attitude he has. After that, he's going to get a little bit political with General Halleck, his immediate superior. Halleck's going to get with him. Halleck's going to be jealous of Grant's success. And so rather than have him in field command, he's going to bump him up to second in command of the Army in the West, right below Halleck. What that does is take him out of the field, and he's essentially in position with no command. Fortunately for him, Halleck's going to be promoted up to command of all the Union armies, and Grant's going to take over for him back in the field. But at this point, he'd almost resigned. He was very close to resigning, and Sherman actually talks him out of it.
I was just going to point out he does the same thing to Meade in 64. Grant does.
Okay. Essentially, he gives him a little bit more leeway than Halleck did. Yeah.
Yeah. A little bit more.
And with that, Grant's moving south, and this just gives you a little bit bigger of a close-up of that map earlier showing the route he took moving south. Holly Springs is going to come up. It's on the cover slide, so I'm not giving anything away. And you can see the route that Van Dorn's going to take to get up there eventually. Now, the great bogeyman, who also is from Ohio, he's born in 1820 in Lancaster, Ohio. If you ever take a tour from somebody from there, make sure you do not call it Lancaster because they get very upset about it. It's Lancaster really quick like that. He's very similar to Farragut. He's actually orphaned. His father passes away, and so he's raised by a family friend, Thomas Ewing. It's good to have friends in high places. Ewing is a senator from Ohio. He also happens to be the first Secretary of the Interior, so if he was around today, he'd be my boss farther up. He's appointed to West Point, mainly for Ewing, and his roommate's going to be George H. Thomas. Sherman's going to write some interesting things about his time at West Point. He's going to say, at the academy, I was not considered a good soldier, for at no time was I selected for any office, but remained a private throughout the whole 4 years. Then, as now, neatness in dress and form, with a strict conformity to the rules, were the qualifications required for office, and I suppose I was found not to excel in any of these. In studies, I always held a respectable reputation with the professors, and generally ranked among the best, especially in drawing, chemistry, mathematics, and natural philosophy. My average demerits per annum were about 150, which reduced my final class standing from 4 to 6. We mentioned drawing in there, and that may sound kind of strange to us today for something that you have to study at West Point. Remember, this is before photographs are easily taken with a small camera. Drawing was how you would, when you would go out and scout lines, say even at Vicksburg here, when the Union Army scouting the Confederate defenses, you'd have staff officers, engineers go forward, and they'd draw out the Confederate position. So it sounds kind of silly today, but at the time, drawing was extremely important in the Army. And Sherman graduates in the class of 1840, and unlike most of his colleagues in the Civil War Army, he does not have an active part in the Mexican-American War. He's sent to California. He's kind of in the rear area there as part of the administration of the new territory, California, that the United States had just acquired in the war. He assists Edward Ward, who will play a part later in the siege, with surveying plots for the future city of Sacramento. He's promoted to captain in 1850. He's going to resign in 1853 to become the San Francisco branch manager of a St. Louis bank. During this time, he's going to suffer from stress-related asthma. He'll later say that he had no fear on a battlefield with an army of 100,000 men. He could capture the city of gold, but he couldn't manage one plot of land in San Francisco that had just scared the death of him. The San Francisco bank branch is going to close in 1857. He's going to move to New York and try to run that branch. You have the financial panic of 1857, and that's going to close that branch, so he's going to be out of a job. He's going to move to Kansas Territory to practice law. That's not going to work out, so, and many of you probably know this, in 1859, he's going to take the job as the first superintendent of Louisiana State Seminary of Learning and Military Academy in Pineville, that's later going to become Louisiana State University. So LSU fans get to claim Sherman, which I'm sure does not go over well at times. When he's there, he's going to speak to one of his colleagues in 1861, and this is probably one of the more prophetic statements you'll ever hear about the Civil War. Now, this colleague's from Virginia, and he's a really ardent secessionist. Sherman says, "You people of the South don't know what you're doing. This country will be drenched in blood, and God only knows how it will end. It is all folly, madness, a crime against civilization. You people speak so lightly of war, you don't know what you're talking about. War is a terrible thing. You mistake, too, the people of the North. They are a peaceable people, but an earnest people, and they will fight, too. They are not going to let this country be destroyed without a mighty effort to save it. Besides, where are your men and appliances of war to contend against them? The North can make a steam engine, locomotive, or railway car. Hardly a yard of cloth or a pair of shoes can you make. You are rushing into war with one of the most powerful, ingeniously mechanical, and determined people on earth, right at your doors. You are bound to fail. Only in your spirit and determination are you prepared for war. In all else, you are totally unprepared, with a bad cause to start with. At first, you will make headway, but as your limited resources begin to fail, shut out from the markets of Europe as you will be, your cause will begin to wane. If your people will but stop and think, they must see in the end that you will surely fail." He pretty much calls it exactly how it's going to be. He's going to be a big part of that, little does he know at the time. He's going to resign from his position as superintendent when he's ordered to accept surrendered arms from the U.S. arsenal in Baton Rouge, when all the states are seceding and they're going to those armories and arsenals, taking whatever they can get their hands on. That's when he resigns, because he refuses to do that. On a side note, after the war, he's going to donate two cannons that were fired on Fort Sumter. They've been able to track them down, and he's going to donate them to LSU. So if you go down to the campus, they're sitting out in front of the military science building. So even after the war, he had a bit of a connection with the university there. In the meantime, he's going to become president of a St. Louis streetcar company. It's kind of like, what doesn't Sherman do? He does all sorts of impressive jobs. He actually turns down an offer to become assistant secretary of war. Remember, he's got those connections in high places. He has a brother who's also a senator, I believe, a representative. A natural brother, not adopted brother. So he has a lot of connections. Instead, he's going to accept an appointment to colonel of the new 13th U.S. Infantry. It's one of the new regular army units they form at the beginning of the war. The 13th is actually going to be playing a big part here at Vicksburg, being the first to plant their flag on the Stockade or Dam complex on May the 19th on the assaults here in 63. He will fight as a brigade commander at First Bull Run. After that, he's going to be promoted to brigadier general. He's going to command the Department of the Cumberland, and while there, the stress is going to get to him again, kind of the way it did in San Francisco. He's not a very self-confident person, which is very surprising when you think about what all he accomplishes later. But he suffers a nervous breakdown in November of 1861, and actually mental illness had run in the Sherman family. And for a time, he actually contemplated suicide. Newspaper articles from Cincinnati are actually going to refer to him as insane. Those are going to spread, so he's going to have that reputation. He's finally going to be assigned to division command after he gets over this whole episode in March of 1862, but basically from March he's recuperating. He's going to fight extremely well at Shiloh after being initially surprised. He's going to be wounded twice there and have three short horses shot out from under him and promoted to major general. Later in 1864, just because we're on the verge of getting into the campaign and we're talking about the personalities, I want to read this quote because it really shows this relationship he had with Grant. After he captures Atlanta, he's getting ready for the march to the sea. Grant's having a terrible time in Virginia. There's a movement to actually replace Grant with Sherman, and he makes this comment. "General Grant," and this is his stress in italics, not mine, "is a great general." He puts a lot of stress on "is a great general." "I know him well. He stood by me when I was crazy, and I stood by him when he was drunk. And now, sir, we stand by each other always. So just think about that comment. Now we're moving up into what's going to become the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou. And if we go back, just as we've dug into the personalities here, we've got the full map here. Remember, Grant's coming down from the middle. Sherman's starting to work down the rivers, and who's going to be involved? The Navy. And one of those Navy vessels, a ship you are all going to become, if you're not already very familiar with, is the USS Cairo. And for those of you that don't know, that is the only known photograph of the Cairo, so that's why you see it all over the place here. That's the only one we have of it. The Cairo is going to move up the Yazoo River. They're part of the scouting expedition in the preparations for Sherman to land and make his attack through Chickasaw Bayou. So it's moving up the Yazoo River, and it's going to be sunk on December 12th by hitting a mine. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail on it because you're going to get a whole kind of field trip with Ray around the boat, and he'll talk about it more. The raid on Holly Springs, this sketch was actually drawn about a week or two before the raid takes place. This is from either Leslie's or Harper's Weekly. I believe Leslie's, one of the newspapers of the time. This is even a closer one of the map we showed before, but you see where the raid begins with. Goes all the way up into Tennessee and around again. A force breaks off going into Tennessee, but Van Dorn hits there. Excuse me, I did that all backwards. Tennessee's the escape route, going all the way up and then back around again. He's going to have a force of about 2,500 men, I believe, from Tennessee, Missouri, and Mississippi. The Union garrison of Holly Springs, they're going to surprise 6 companies of infantry from Illinois and 6 companies of cavalry from Illinois. And they're just going to completely surprise them. They're going to destroy all the supplies there. Van Dorn estimates that they destroy about $1.5 million worth of supplies. Remember, these are all the supplies for Grant's army. That's the huge supply depot. So everything you can think of would be there, and they destroy it all. With that, Grant cannot move forward anymore because he has nothing to fight with, no food, no bullets, no ammunition, none of that. It's all gone. The Confederates also take whatever horses they find there. Interesting side note, there's a visitor in Holly Springs with Van Dorn's cavalry raids in there. Grant's wife, Julia Dent Grant, is actually in town there. That's thought to be the safe area. And she's in a house there. Van Dorn finds out, and he actually puts a guard around the house to keep her from being disturbed. The Confederate forces do accidentally burn her carriage. They're getting a little excited and carried away before the guards put up. They didn't know it was hers properly. But anyway, he acts very gentlemanly and protects her from any aggression. But Grant's pulled out, and with Grant pulled out, there's nothing to hold the Confederate forces up in this area. In the meantime, they're getting reports that there's a strong Union force moving down the Mississippi River. So these Confederate troops, a lot of them are going to be hustled back on the railroad, back into the defenses north of town. And that's going to break into the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou. Sherman's going to attack anyway. He's going to move through these marshy areas north of town. The Confederate line's roughly along Highway 61 here. That's where that historical marker is. They're going to attack through the swamps. It's a 2-day battle. That's the first day. That's the second day. You can see where they inch closer. There's an account from the 13th Infantry, Sherman's old unit. They're fighting here at Chickasaw Bayou also. One of the soldiers is going to make the comment that night in between, it was so cold. Remember, it's December, right around New Year's. It's so cold when they wake up in the morning, you couldn't tell the dead soldiers from the live soldiers because everybody's skin had a bluish tint to it. That's how cold it was. So just to give you an idea how nasty that situation was. Sherman's going to be repulsed there. The Battle of Chickasaw Bayou is going to be one of only 2 defeats that the Union Army of the Tennessee ever faces. This and the Battle of Kennesaw Mountain during the Atlanta campaign where they're repulsed in a very similar attack against rough terrain there, but only 2 defeats. There's a very good book written on the Army of the Tennessee called Nothing But Victory. It emphasizes that fact. There's about 1,800 U.S. casualties compared to just 200 Confederate casualties, so it's a very overwhelming Confederate victory. After this, General John McClernand arrives. McClernand's very interesting. I've talked about all these naval officers, army officers on both sides. They're all professionals. He's a professional politician. He's born in 1812 in Kentucky, and his family moves to Illinois when he's younger. He's a self-educated lawyer, very ambitious. He'll actually serve as a private during the Black Hawk Indian War, if you want to call it a war. It's really a rough patch for those Native Americans that really get beat up on. But he serves during that war. Afterwards, he's going to be the founder and editor of the Shawnee Democrat newspaper. So with that, you can tell he's on the Democratic side of politics. He's going to serve as a Democrat in the Illinois House of Representatives in 1836 and then 1840 through 1843. His mentor is going to be Stephen Douglas, a name you should all be familiar with. From 1843 to 51 and then 1859 to 1861, he's going to serve in the United States House of Representatives. His first term, he's going to strongly oppose the Wilmot Proviso. The Wilmot Proviso occurs when they're trying to figure out the treaty for the Mexican-American War. And Wilmot adds that all these territories should not come into slave states. And it causes a really big issue. He strongly supports that, meaning that he's on the side of the pro-slavery. He strongly opposes it. His second term, however, the war is getting closer and closer, and he's actually a very strong unionist in his second term. Remember, Southern Illinois is very divided. A lot of the people that had moved into Southern Illinois had Confederate leanings. There's actually a Tennessee regiment that about half their strength had come from men who had left Illinois to go fight for the South at the start of the Civil War. So Southern Illinois is very divided. McClernand himself disliked abolitionists. Even though he was a unionist, he was not for abolition. This is actually going to cost him speakership of the House in 1860. He was a very strong candidate to become Speaker of the House, but he's not elected because of that. He's going to serve as an advisor and campaign manager for Stephen Douglas in the 1860 election. And at the start of the war, he's going to resign from Congress, and Abraham Lincoln's going to make sure he's commissioned as a brigadier general. This is not due to all the great military knowledge he learned as a private during the Black Hawk Indian War. This is, as I mentioned, with Southern Illinois, that's to try to keep them firm in the grasp of the Union, because there is some worry there for a time. He's going to fight under Grant at the Battle of Belmont and Fort Donelson, and for somebody with no experience, he actually does perform fairly well. He's going to be promoted to Major General in March of 1862. He's going to fight well at Charlotte, but his constant political maneuvering caused resentment among fellow officers. He's always trying to work angles, and that's going to cause trouble. He's going to arrive on the scene right after the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou, and outranking Sherman, he takes over his force, and he decides to go off and attack Lonely Fort Hindman on Arkansas Post. And I'm just going to mention Arkansas Post briefly. It's an overwhelming Union victory. With McClernand and Sherman's troops with the support of Porter's gunboats. But I'm just going to mention it briefly enough to go over the opposing strategic mindsets. McClernand very much wants a quick victory, and in his defense, it really does help the morale of Sherman's men. They're down in the depths after the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou, and this quick victory helps pick them up. Grant's mindset is, let's not get torn away from our goal. Let's go after Vicksburg. If this doesn't help us, go after Vicksburg. Let's not waste our time. Move towards Vicksburg, move towards Vicksburg, move towards Vicksburg. So that's just to show the differing mindsets there. Grant's very goal-oriented, keep towards the finish. McClernand, on the other hand, it may have been a little bit of a way for him to grasp headlines, but Grant's focus is always on Vicksburg. And you have the start of the very famous Grant versus McClernand feud that's going to play out into the spring and into the siege. McClernand had the bad habit of communicating directly with a pre-war friend he had, who happened to be commander-in-chief, Abraham Lincoln. And in these communications, he'd offer criticisms of other generals' strategies, specifically General McClellan and General Grant. So that obviously caused issues. In October of 1862, he'd obtain leave, and he'd actually visit Lincoln in Washington, hoping to angle an important independent command. And there's some famous pictures. In the middle, of course, is Abraham Lincoln. This is McClernand off to the side, and this is Alan Pinkerton, the starter of Pinkerton's private detectives, who was kind of chief of intelligence for the Army of the Potomac. And the next picture, an extremely famous picture, this is McClellan's staff. That's McClellan there. There's Lincoln. This is after the Battle of Antietam when Lincoln moves for his inspection tour of the Army of the Potomac and kind of wondering why they aren't moving after Lee. Off in the shadows to the side here is General McClernand. So he's hobnobbing, trying to angle anything he can get. He finally gets what he wants. He's given orders to raise troops to help in the drive against Vicksburg. But there's just some discrepancy. He thinks these are going to be his troops that he can do whatever he wants with. But the West Pointers stick together in this. General Halleck makes sure that he words the orders that any troops coming into Grant's department will be under Grant's command. So that's the way they step around McClernand's ambition. McClernand doesn't like Sherman. At Arkansas Post, he really doesn't like Sherman, has issues with West Pointers. Which is kind of interesting because after the war, his son's going to go to West Point. He's actually going to become a Medal of Honor winner during the Indian Wars and rise to the rank of Brigadier General. During the Civil War, at least, he's not a fan of West Pointers. Doesn't like Sherman. So you have this interesting dichotomy. Remember we talked about Porter being kind of cliquey and being very animated. He had liked Sherman, so this automatically made him not like McClernand. Sherman actually, he always has this reputation of being a really rough and having a wild temper. I guess there's a picture where his hair's all over, it looks kind of wild and crazy. But he's actually the one during the Arkansas Post Expedition trying to keep the peace between McClernand and Porter to keep things moving in the right direction. So in conclusion, the actions and personalities of 1862 are what set the stage for the final successful Union drive in 1863. Both the Army and the Navy are going to try separately to capture the city of Vicksburg on their own. Both are going to fail, learning through trial and error that they needed to work together. The personalities are either going to rise to new heights in the next year or begin to recede and fade away. I want to thank you all for coming. If anybody has any questions, I'd love to try to answer them for you the best I can.
Real quick. I know the answer. Where's Chickasaw Bayou?
For those that don't know. Just north of Vicksburg. Actually, if you go up to Fort Hill in the park, that's a great vantage point. Just look north where the Port of Vicksburg is, and a little bit north of that's the area where it is. If you go on 61 north, Business 61, there is a historical marker there. It's very small.
Is that King's?
It's where Anson Tully's got all that lumber right there, and they're spraying on it all the time. Just on the other side of the
Chickasaw Bayou. King's, that area there?
As a plug for Eastern National, they do have the North and South magazine that has the driving tour you can take of the Chickasaw Bayou battlefield. So that'll get you around in that area. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. General Parker Hill said there was some mound of some sort, an Indian mound.
There is.
Where there's a cannon emplacement on Stephen D. Lee's.
Yeah, it's on the map here. Let me get back to it.
I went out there to look at it. I couldn't ever find it.
There's a pole barn on top of it.
Yeah.
It's you can see on the map there. Forget off the top of my head the name of the road that goes through there. You can only go so far and then it's blocked off, but that Indian mound actually has a metal pole barn on top of it right now. What's that?
King's Gym Road.
King's Gym Road.
He refused to take our little group out to it because he said the pit bulls might get us.
It's called King's Gym
Road. Pole barn. Metal outbuilding.
G-I-N.
He calls pole barn.
turn it on there and just sit back there. I said, it's a pole barn. A barn made of pole.
Yeah,
pole barn.
That must be an Ohio thing, I guess.
Yes, sir. Could you say a little bit more about the path of the Carroll there and exactly when it was sunk relative to the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou? This was
the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou is late December 28th, 29th. The Cairo sinks December 12th, so about 2 weeks before this. This is way before the Army even lands. The Navy's up there kind of scouting around, getting ready for when the Army does come and they can make their landings. That's when it sunk.
So it came down from a series of bayous from...
It went from the Mississippi right into the Yazoo.
Oh, it went from the Mississippi up...
Yeah, the Cairo is part of the garrison of Memphis, helping to hold on to Memphis, because there's still Confederate cavalry raids, forces up around there, or getting ready to be up around there. You've got a lot of different guerrilla groups, so the Cairo's up at Memphis. It gets orders to come down to be part of this expedition, and actually a couple days after it arrives down here is when it's sent upriver and sunk. Yes, sir.
Could you pinpoint on the map where the Cairo sank?
I actually don't think I have a map that will cover that on here. It'll be off the map.
It was 12 miles up the river.
Is it as far as the city?
No. Yeah, if you're going on that 161 over the Yazoo River, it's to the west of there. No. Just to give you a rough idea. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? All right, well, everybody have a good night. We'll see you next Tuesday.
Oh, yeah.
It's a military war. I read it correctly.